Welcome to the Monetary Policy Special. No rate cut, nor was it expected. But the big headline in this monetary policy is the MPC changed its stance from the hawkish withdrawal of accommodation to a more dovish neutral stance. However, the governor was very careful to dilute the dovish stance. Just hear him out.
The MPC considered it appropriate to change the stance to neutral and to remain unambiguously focused on a durable alignment of inflation with the target while, of course, supporting growth.
Okay. He repeated that unambiguously about four times. Now, also hear out Deputy Governor Patra when he spoke about the same issue.
We will like to see off the near-term hump in inflation, which we all our projections suggest is going to happen. We want to see it off carefully before even considering the next move.
Now, what did Dr. Patra mean by the hump? Just look at the inflation numbers. June was 5.08. July, August, we got a 3% plus number. But the September and October numbers, I have just a dipstick poll. September is expected to be 5.2 and October is expected to be 5. These are the two numbers that the Reserve Bank will have when it goes on December 6th for its next policy. Very tough to cut with two 5% rates just behind you. So this appears to be a change in dovish stance with a liberal dose of hawkish. So it seems to me, but what's the impact? What's the takeaway for economists, bond market experts and for bankers? I have with me an elite panel, SBI Chairman, Mr. C.S. Sethi, Mridul Sagar, former MPC member and now Professor of Finance at IIM Kozhikode, B. Prasanna, the Head of Global Treasury at ICICI Bank, and Samiran Chakrabarty, the Chief Economist from Citibank India. Gentlemen, thank you very much for joining me in what should have been a busy day for all of you. Well, let me start with the bond guy first. Prasanna, the yields have, I guess the market was taken by a pleasant surprise. What is the sense you are getting now? Will the market build a structural bullishness for bonds or, falling yields?
So I think, Lata, structural bullishness for bonds was already getting formed, right? We started the year much higher at 7 and we're already at 670s. But beyond that, I think into the policy, I would say roughly around 50% of the market participants kind of expected a change, while most of the others thought that he'll probably talk a little dovish outside the policy, but the change in stance will be in December and a rate cut might either be in December or in February. So to that extent, I think this change in stance was a little bit pleasant surprise for the markets. Frankly, there were two options that the governor could have done. He could have either, not changed the stance but talked dovish, or he could have changed the stance but acted really neutral in his talk. I think he chose to do the latter. And that's why in your introduction also you made the point about how neutral they are getting. So from all this, I think the trajectory of bond deals, I think, frankly, does not change much. We are still headed towards 650 or 655 probably by March of this financial year. But of course, whether the next rate cut is in the bag or it's not in the bag, like the hump that you're talking about, they will see two inflation readings which are on the higher side. But on the other hand, they would see Fed having cut. So there's a lot of things which happens between now and December. So I would place a higher than 50% probability of a December, but between December and February, definitely a cut of 25 basis points is there. And bond markets will start looking towards that possibility.
Okay. Let me get one more opinion before I go to the banker and ask him what his troubles are with a falling rate. Samiran, your take. From what the governor said, the hedged dovishness, are you sensing December or do you think he'll pass December and go to February for the first rate cut?
We think that by the stance change, the governor has got some flexibility, some optionality with him in terms of choosing the rate cut. But I don't think there is any guidance from today's policy about the timing of the rate cut. In December, the two inflation prints that will be with him will likely to be more than 5%. It would be much harder to cut rates in the December policy, according to us. What can change, and I think this is quite crucial, is that we will have some idea about how the festive season demand has played out as well as by November end, we will have the September quarter GDP data. So to what extent that forces RBI to change its growth outlook would be critical. And the balance of risks between growth and inflation, which in this policy the governor mentioned as being well poised, whether that changes in the December policy is something that we have to see. In our baseline scenario, we are expecting the cut more to be February than December. In fact, there is a risk that it can be delayed further to April also, if the growth numbers remain more comfortable and RBI decides to actually wait for the actual inflation numbers to fall to 4 and stay there, rather than work on the basis of forward-looking inflation to be meeting 4%. I think that is going to be quite critical.
No, he did insist that, you know, expected inflation, he said it several times, almost as many times as he said unambiguously. So my sense is that expected inflation towards 4 should suffice. Just a word, Prasanna says 6.55 by end of year, you said, right, Prasanna? You agree with that, Samiran? The yields go to almost 6.5 by March?
Yes, we have a similar forecast.
Okay. The, Mr. Sethi, that brings it squarely to you. Do you see this as a big problem? The as it is, there will be a lot of your loans tied to T-bills and, you know, money market instruments. That will be priced lower. Corporates can go and borrow from the market. So do you have a problem that your borrower is able to dictate terms to you? Your depositor is also dictating terms to you. Do you have a problem?
Yeah, Lata, I think without getting into the nitty-gritty of it, but I think our portfolio, SBI portfolio, repo-linked portfolio is less, and even T-bill-linked is less. We have predominantly a floating rate in terms of MCLR-linked portfolio. That the transition in MCLR is slightly longer than what happens in kind of the rate cut is happening and the repo is reduced. But our view, I think we still hold on to the house view, and also the economist taking a view that the rate cut, first rate cut probably will be in February. So which means that the impact on reduced rates on the floating rate loans will not be immediate. That is number one. Okay. Number two, the depositors demanding for higher rate, I think that is the question of supply and demand. As we keep saying, I think depositors definitely look for proper compensation. But the real rates of interest are better now when compared to what it used to be earlier. There has been readjustment of interest rate on deposits for the last few months. Today, I think banks are willing to pay 1 to 2 year deposit around 7.25% to 7.5%, giving a real return on the deposits.
Yes.
So we, in a way, I think these rates will continue for some more time. You know, the rate cut happening in February is also a very interesting thing. You have not asked me, but I still would like to volunteer on that.
Yes.
And I think for the first time, the central bank probably would be, if central bank is confident that the growth rate of 7.2 or 7% is likely to be there in FY25 and FY26, we would have a very special situation where the rate cut will happen when the growth is good.
Yes. Yes.
So this is something which we witness in other countries also. I think it's happened in the US, it happened in Philippines. So this shows confidence of central bank on the growth trajectory, which is a good tiding for us.
Yeah.
While we will have some challenges on the rates, but I think the growth will compensate for that.
No, I am going to come full on the growth question as well. I had to take one at a time. But just a nitty-gritty, Mr. Sethi, you know, you will have to have the liquidity coverage ratio on you sooner or later. Now, will it be tempting for the banks to convert a bank like you, who is giving a lot of loans to AAA companies, to simply convert it into a bond? In that case, you meet your LCR requirements. Will it work that way? And therefore, some of your pain reduced?
No, I don't get how the lending and bond is going to help me in the LCR.
No, it'll count as HQLA, isn't it?
No. Corporate okay, bonds don't count for HQLA. Most of them don't.
But G-Secs do. Yeah, so, G-Secs will.
Yeah.
But Prasanna, isn't some level of HTM corporate bond likely to get counted as HQLA? No?
No, especially the bonds issued by the non-financial sector will get counted as HQLA. So to that extent, I think you can assume that the AAA bonds and the AA plus bonds, which are the most prominent issuers, are the ones who are likely to, you know, benefit if the LCR guidelines were to come into play.
Okay. So, you know, there was a banker telling me that that may be a window of relief because they will be able to convert some of their loans to, say, a Tata Steel or any other AAA company. Maybe not so many of them are bond issuers, but that could be a bit of a relief from the very high liquidity cover that banks will have to accumulate. Mr. Sethi, I'll come to you in a minute. But Mridul, were you surprised by the neutral stance, the conversion to neutral stance? And what did you make of exactly the question that Mr. Sethi has put on our plate? That at a time of high growth, 7.2 and 7.1, the Reserve Bank will go ahead and cut, you think? Say, even in February?
So, Lata, I was not at all surprised that they moved to neutral. I think it was a bit overdue to communicate that. What is important to note is that the stance has been changed after 19 months from February 23. And withdrawal of accommodation phrase has been dropped after 29 months.
Yes.
So, that's important. And plus, central bank has returned to a neutral stance after a full period of 5 years and 4 months. So this is not without significance. It's not just incremental change that is there. Having said that, to your original question, whether the cut will come or not, that prognosis is still difficult and might take the same as what the SBI was saying, probably in February. We have this comfort of low inflation, core inflation, for quite some time. And if the headline falls towards the core, as it should be, I think there will be space to do a very shallow rate cut cycle. And that's what Reserve Bank seems to be preparing for. But that is not a certainty, as it was repeatedly said. There are a lot of uncertainties around, especially hinting at the geostrategic issues which can spike the oil price at any point of time, though RBI has reduced the oil price forecast because 85 was becoming very difficult with the kind of average
to justify. Yeah.
So I think they're preparing for a window that if forward-looking data allows them, they can do some shallow rate cut cycle.
Okay. Fair enough. But even a shallow rate cut, even if it is two cuts, there are some people with three. Okay, Samiran, that question to you. First of all, you're buying the 7.2 and 7.1 forecast, which the governor put on the table. The Reserve Bank is the highest on the street in terms of growth estimate. But they were last year as well. And it was the street which followed Reserve Bank. Reserve Bank was right. And today, the confidence with which, the emphasis with which the governor argued his 7.2 forecast was stunning, was telling. Have you changed your growth forecast? And therefore, what do you make of what Mr. Sethi said, that we are going to get rate cuts in a strong growth cycle?
So, Lata, first, our numbers are marginally lower than what the RBI's numbers are. But I think the street is trying to be even lower than our 7% growth forecast. The primary reason is that the June to September quarter, we haven't actually seen the kind of pickup that we would have anticipated after the April-June quarter distorted by election and heat wave. RBI has acknowledged that and reduced their own number from 7.2 to 7 for this particular quarter, but has adjusted upwards the other two quarters for the rest of the year. So the overall number has remained the same. And there, I think the critical assumption is about government expenditure. Right now, to meet the full year capex target of the central government for rest of the year, public capex has to grow at more than 40%. If we see that sort of a spend, then clearly the GDP growth numbers will look better. But if the government is unable to spend at that pace, then there is downside risk to the GDP numbers. And the other risk that we have to see, and over the next couple of months, we will probably have some anecdotal evidence on this, is on urban consumption. There is some signs of softness there, particularly what the number that I noticed was even the GST payment growth for the last month was only about 6%. We will have to see how that thing pans out. And by end November, when we get the September quarter GDP data, we'll know that to what extent the full year GDP growth number we can keep at around that 7% handle.
Okay. No, that's a fair point. But even the US GDP has been surprising on the upside. I mean, the last number was 3%. So somehow I'm more prepared for upside surprises in GDP. So that puts two questions actually to State Bank and the entire banking sector. They are one third of the banking sector. First, how much will their margins crunch? How much will they be able to make up for it by a growth in the loan book itself? All those questions in a minute after a very short break.